Hello everyone, welcome to week four. I'm coming to you from C-SPAN's offices here in Washington, D.C. I thought this would be a fun place to shoot the video. Maybe later, maybe for next week's video, I'll show you some behind the scenes stuff of what's going on here. First off, with housekeeping things, go back and check your quizzes again. There was one question that I thought was really kind of unfair, and I gave you some points for that. We'll go over the quiz questions in a minute here, so I can kind of give you what I was thinking with those and help you to understand. I've also given you feedback for your wiki section outlines. Make sure you check out that. If you have any questions, let me know on email. All right, so let's look at a couple of quiz questions first. The first one has to do with the simplest solution Lessig proposes to making copyright laws more egalitarian and mutually beneficial. All the answers here are things that he proposed. But one of the biggest things, and I think the thing that's kind of overarching about all of these answers, is this idea of requiring people to actually apply for copyright. That, he says, forces them to really think about how they're using copyright and how they want their material to be used. The second question that threw a few of you is Lessig's main beef with copyright laws. And again, these are answers that I think all of them kind of fit, but the key overarching one that I was looking for was that they are criminalizing something that we all do. He's not saying that there should be no copyright or that should we be able to download whatever we want, but he says it has to make sense. I also ended up giving you extra points for this question about hybrid economies. The correct answer was both the audience and the business work together to create value for each other, but I think the second answer, that the business profits while the audience feels fairly compensated, is really similar, kind of an unfair question, and those of you that answered that, I think you were right on the mark. Now some overall comments about your wikis. Remember how we read online, and that's one of the reasons I'm having you do it as a wiki rather than as a research project, because I want you to think about what the online presentation will be and what audiences will get the most from your wikis. So that's why I'm really encouraging you to do short, to the point sections. Make sure your sections are really tightly focused. Also, as you're putting the sections together and as you're actually completing the wiki through the software online, make sure you look for connections. Remember, with a wiki, you don't have to start at the beginning and go down through the end. You can start in the middle. And the way that we can guide people through the process is by making clear the interconnections between different sections, between our wiki and other wiki, between our wikis and other pages. That's one of the reasons why I'm asking you to add a multimedia element. You know, not something that you have to create yourself, but something that you link to, because a part of this exercise is getting you familiar with the link economy and how we can build our content through other content. And when you make calls to action, make sure that they're very specific and ask more for facts and examples rather than opinions. You know, we're not looking for just comments about this. We're looking for people to add knowledge to the wiki that we're doing. All right, now to the example for this week. I think some of you struggled with the idea of what a hybrid economy is and how that really would work in journalism. A lot of you noticed that, you know, the hybrid has to involve the audience more, but I think what the concept that you missed was that the hybrid economy actually uses the audience to make journalism better and more easy. And the example that I thought of about this was the Northwest Voice in Bakersfield, California. This was one of the first citizen journalism websites in the United States. And a couple of things that it does is it is really unique that I still actually haven't seen in a lot of citizen journalism ventures. You know, one, its content is entirely written by the audience. But second, the editor is very active in going out into the community and soliciting people to write for the site. In addition, the editor works with them really carefully and closely to make sure that their content is something that they can be really proud of and something that fits with the mission of what the Bakersfield Voice is trying to do. Finally, and this is where the hybrid economy really comes in, now if you see down here in the corner, they do a weekly print edition where they collect the best responses from the website. And they deliver that to every home in Bakersfield. It's a standard strategy that we used to use in the newspaper business a lot, called the TMC, or Total Market Coverage. It's the same thing like you get the flyers in your mailbox with ads. This is a way that newspapers can maximize their delivery systems to offer a similar product to advertisers. Usually we just fill these with AP content, wire stories about entertainment. But when we started to actually put content that was important to people, that was interesting to people, we got a lot better pickup rates, advertisers liked it better, and I think we did a better service for our audience. So how does this example fit in with the readings and fit in with some of the things that you were talking about? Well, one of the most important things that you highlighted in your papers was the importance of diversity. In the end, however, the bottom line of the Internet's foundation is simple. It is a network of convergence and compilation. diverse ideas, organizations, and bounties of knowledge from varying realms happily live together in the cloud. If the efforts to override diversity do not fail against themselves, they will fail against the common ground of a society who is constantly pushing for more knowledge. This author really seized upon the idea that not only is diversity important, but it's also going to drive itself. If we don't provide diversity, then our audience is going to look for it elsewhere. And that really fits in with the mission of what journalists are trying to do. This week's readings deal a lot with the practice of how integrating some of these ideas that we've talked about work. And I thought there was a really interesting comment from one of your papers this week that meshes well with that. The Creative Commons of the Internet should be emphasized more as a culture of innovation that has perks which allow users to generate capital, not as a market for property and big business monopolies to thrive. Is the restriction of expression for corporate interests really worth the hindrance of knowledge and cultural advances that come along with it? Perhaps we will one day find a happy medium. I like this comment because it emphasizes that there's more currency on the internet than just dollars that we raise, and that there is room for small entities, and we really shortchange ourselves when we let the big businesses monopolize what we're seeing online. And how do we find ways to involve the community? How do we go beyond our natural tendencies to not listen? Well, this writer sums it up really well. Simply being big and strong isn't enough in the digital age. You have to know your community and contribute a certain amount without immediately asking for money. Instead, listen. Like Google does with tracking search results, use this information to learn your readers better. Then when it is time to sell, you know exactly what they want. This is a strategy that a lot of really successful companies have used. If you've watched The Social Network, Mark Zuckerberg, you know, the fictional version of Mark Zuckerberg anyway, talks about this in the film, how he wants to make sure that Facebook has a strong user base, a strong user community, before they even think about making money. I know sometimes I tend to think in absolute terms, you know, to think of this is the right way to do things, and not to think of does this really work in the real world. And so that's why I think this quote was really important. How might a professional journalist make a profit in the informational climate? Perhaps the more important question is, what purpose is there for professional journalism at all? I would argue that this should be the central question on any professional journalist's mind when producing content, and from that perspective, it should be self-evident, because we do it better than anyone else. Quality will continue to turn a profit. Yes, that statement might be a bit naive, but I think it's an attitude that we have to have, because I agree with this author that we need journalists more than ever in the digital age. People are willing to support good journalism and good information. You know, especially information that gives them an advantage or helps them make a decision, which again is cool, is central to what we're trying to do as journalists. As I've already highlighted throughout the video this week, the readings focus on the practice. These are all studies conducted by researchers working with professional journalists and looking at what they're doing and applying some of these theories that we've already read about to see how effective what they're doing is. The book Participatory Journalism, where I took the Domingo and the Paulson reading, came about when a group of researchers spent a lot of time in newsrooms talking with journalists, seeing what they're doing, seeing how these theories really apply. In the other two studies by two professors at Ohio University, we both went to journalists and asked them what they were doing and asked them about their attitudes toward user-generated content. We both found to some extent that their attitudes really made a difference. One of my goals with this class and to exposing students to a lot of the theories that we're looking at is to change some attitudes, is to make journalism students at least, and hopefully journalists when they get out in the field, more open to using their audience. And I think that's going to make a huge difference in the quality of content that we get and how useful it can be. Thanks again for watching. I can't believe we only have 3 weeks left after this week. If you have any questions about your final wiki projects, just let me know at my email, as usual. Next week, I'll come to you again here from C-SPAN, and I'll be back in Athens on June 22nd. Thanks again. Have a great week.